Good evening, everyone. Can I thank you for coming this evening to our evening Harvest Thanksgiving service? It's great that you've decided to take time out tonight to come to lift up the Lord of the Harvest on this the evening hour of his day. Can I welcome any visitors? It's good to have you with us. And if there's anybody listening to the service on YouTube or Facebook or DVD or CD, we trust you'll also be blessed as you worship the Lord with us in this way. Just a couple of brief announcements before we start our service, just to reiterate that it has been decided that 70% of this year's Harvest Appeal offering will be used to offset the costs of all the visual and audio technology recently installed in our building. And the remaining 30% is going to be equally divided between the CEF, CEV House Redevelopment Project, and the work of Mission Possible in Bogota, Colombia. Then just an announcement with regards to midweek. Midweek continues on Wednesday evening. This Wednesday evening, it's our large group teaching. It will take place in the church building here, and possibly it will be recorded for those who are still shielding and can't be with us. We'll be looking at Romans chapter 8, verses 1 to 13, if you want to read in advance, and the Bible study guides for our Disciples Who Grow groups, which will start a fortnight after that, will be available for collection on Wednesday evening. The Grow groups commence for the ladies on the Tuesday, the 27th of October at 10 a.m. in the church hall. And then for others, men and women, there is one group meeting in the church hall on Wednesday, the 28th at 8 p.m., whilst at the same time, two other groups will meet on Zoom. Those are all our announcements. I want to read again that call to worship we read this morning. It just reminds us that God is a faithful and really a remarkably good God. It comes in the context after God had flooded the entire earth, and Noah built an altar to the Lord, and Noah took some of every clean animal and some of every clean bird and offered the burnt offerings on the altar. And when the Lord smelt the pleasing aroma, he said in his heart, I will never again curse the ground because of man. Whilst the earth remains, seed time and harvest, cold and heat, summer and winter, day and night shall not cease. We come again this evening to give thanks to the Lord of the harvest. We're going to sing a lovely harvest piece. It's hymn 617, Fountain of Mercy, God of Love, how rich thy bounties are. Let us stand together as we worship God. good singing. Let's again approach the throne of grace in prayer. Let's pray together. Lord of the harvest, once again we return to this house in the evening hour of your day, that one day in seven that you've set aside for the worship of yourself. We thank you for the privilege. We thank you for the freedom. We thank you for the liberty and the health and strength that we have to come to meet together tonight, to lift up our voices in praise and to worship you in spirit and in truth. Lord, as we declared this morning, you truly are a good and a loving God. You pour out your mercy day after day upon us as if it were coming from an overflowing fountain. Your goodness once again has been displayed to us at this harvest time, that time which began with the planting and the sowing, and then the mowing and the growing, and now the reaping has taken place. We thank it all has been safely gathered in. We thank you once again for your generosity towards us, undeserving sinners. Lord, we don't deserve such bounty, but you continue to pour it out upon us. In spite of the fact that often we forget about you, we forget the one who gives every good gift to us, you continue to be gracious and to be merciful to us, not only providing for our physical needs, but more importantly, our spiritual needs through your Son, our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you Jesus Christ did come into this world to save sinners such as us. We thank you, Lord, that we still are living in days of grace and days of time whenever we can seek you, and we will find you whenever we seek you with all of our hearts. We thank you for many here this evening who have sought you and have found you. But forgive us, merciful Father, whenever we do forget that you indeed should be the most important person in our life. Forgive us whenever we fail to worship you as we should. Forgive us even for the arrogance of thinking that, as we sometimes do, that we are doing you a favor by coming here this evening, when after all, you are the one who has given us everything we have, and it is only right and proper so to do. Forgive us even for those times whenever we think that as Christians that the work of the harvest will not be complete without our own selfish and often miserable efforts. Open our eyes, melt our hearts, help us to understand in our minds just who you are. You're the Lord of the harvest, Lord, and you don't need any one of us. You can save souls with or without us. You can build up your church because you're sovereign. But we thank you that in your great plan you use sinners such as us who've been saved by your grace. Grant us humility. Grant us grace. Fill us with your Holy Spirit that we may continue to be used in the work of the harvest. And help every professing believer in this place tonight to cultivate the fruit of the Spirit in our life, that we might become more and more like Jesus. Not only the things we say, but the things that we do will reach others for Christ. Lord, we ask these things in Jesus' name and for his glory. Our reading this evening is from Galatians chapter 6, we're reading verses 1 to 10. Galatians chapter 6, verses 1 to 10. Let us hear God's word. Brothers, if anyone is caught in any transgression, you who are spiritual should restore him in a spirit of gentleness. But keep watch on yourself, lest you too be tempted. Bear one another's burdens, and so fulfill the law of Christ. For if anyone thinks he is something, when he is nothing, he deceives himself. But let each one of us test his own work, and then his reason to boast will be in himself alone and not in his neighbor, for each will have to bear his own load. One who is taught the word must share all good things with the one who teaches. Do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever one sows, that will he also reap. For the one who sows to his own flesh will from the flesh reap corruption. But the one who sows to the Spirit will from the Spirit reap eternal life. And let us not grow weary of doing good, for in due season we will reap, if we do not give up. So then, as we have had opportunity, let us do good to everyone, and especially to those who are of the household of faith. Amen. And we trust the Lord will bless the reading of his word to our heart's understanding here this evening. Sarah and Ella and Mulholland are going to come and bring their first piece. It's entitled The Goodness of God.
Thank you.
Thanks, Gers. Again, we're reminded of God's goodness to us, of course, at this time of the harvest. We're going to bring our prayers of intercession this evening. We're going to give thanks to God, not only for the harvest, but also for, indeed, his bounty to us every day. But we want to also pray for the causes that we're supporting this evening and this morning as a result of our harvest appeal. We want to pray that God will use this visual sound ministry for his glory. There are many elderly members in our congregation who genuinely can't be to church, and they long to hear the services on CDs or DVDs or on Facebook or YouTube or whatever. And we think that this God will bless this, and we pray that he will use that for his glory. There also are some people who are shielding at this time who have been able to avail of this. So we thank God for the young men who have been gifted to help us with this aspect of our ministry as well. I want to pray for the work and mission of Mission Possible in Bogota, Colombia, Hope House 1, Hope House 2, and all the feeding programs and the church that's going on over there in Colombia. People much less fortunate than we are. We want to pray for that. And also the Seaview House Redevelopment Project. Basically what that is Seaview House is a place down in Kilkeel. It's a building used by Child Evangelism Fellowship for training of young people to do summer holiday Bible clubs. A lot of our young people over this past number of years have went there, spent 3 days or a week and have been trained, and now we are reaping the benefit from their training. But that old building had to be tumbled, and they're currently rebuilding a new building down there. So we want to pray for these three causes. Let's just unite our hearts together and pray. Father, we do give you thanks for your generosity towards us. We thank you, Lord, that we have an opportunity, especially at the harvest time, to give that little bit extra to the work of the gospel. And Lord, tonight we do want to pray for these three causes especially. We pray for our new audiovisual technology in this congregation. We bless you. We thank you for the young men and women who have the gifts to use it and to develop it in the weeks and months that lie ahead. And we pray indeed that you will use it for your glory, perhaps even to save souls, and certainly to sanctify and encourage your people. Father, we are so fortunate, and we're reminded tonight of those who are less fortunate than ourselves, and that is why we're giving some of our gifts to the work of Mission Possible across there in Bogota, Colombia. We thank you, Lord, that Joe and Sadie, in a sense, have retired from that work, and that OMS have taken over it, and we pray for continued progress in the work of the gospel through the work of Mission Possible and OMS. We pray, Lord, that what we might give over this harvest time would be used to your glory, to feed stomachs of children who cannot normally be fed, to educate them, and especially to teach them your truth, the unsearchable riches of the gospel. We do also thank you for CV House and all that has meant to many people down through the years. We know that CEF have a plan, and they're already in the midst of redeveloping CV House. And we pray indeed, Lord, that you would continue to raise up the finances through people such as us, that building would be complete and in the future would be used again to train young people to go out and to sow the seed of the gospel wherever you would call them. Tonight also we're mindful of those in our congregations whose needs are greatest. We pray that you would meet such people at their points of need, those who are sick, those who are currently bereaving, those who also who are in nursing homes, lonely and anxious and worried at this time. Father, grant them that peace and that mercy that you alone can grant. We bring all these prayers to you in Jesus' name for his glory. Amen. The girls are going to come and sing before I preach the word of God. Their second piece, Lord, I Need You. Oh, I Need You. You. You again, girls. You might get your pocket money this week. Think, do they deserve it? Only joking. They don't get pocket money. Thank you, Matthew, as well, for playing the background music. It's lovely. It's nice to see what this technology can do. It makes it so much easier. So thank you, Matthew, for that as well as the girls. Again, just seek the Lord in prayer before we come to his word. Father, we do thank you that whenever we call upon you, whenever we seek your face, you're always there to enable and to empower us to live for you. And Lord, as a preacher of your word, I realize my own feelings, my weaknesses. And so, Lord, I ask that your Holy Spirit will come. You will help me. You will strengthen me. You will equip me to preach your truth. And Father, we pray that same Holy Spirit will illuminate your word to every heart in this place. For those who are yours, that you will encourage us, you will mold us and shape us more and more to be like Jesus. For those who are not, Father, you would even see fit to grant the gift of faith. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. There once was a little boy, and he just loved to escape to an old fruit tree that was located just behind his house. The old tree was full of leaves, but it hadn't produced any fruit for years. But high up on the branches, there was the perfect spot where a little boy could just sit and simply dream away the hours. Whenever the little boy went there, he could imagine he was anything from a spaceship commander traveling to unknown galaxies, or Tarzan climbing, indeed, through all the jungle terrain that we know from the TV series Tarzan. Whenever the young boy felt mistreated, whenever he felt misunderstood, even whenever he felt lonely, he would just get away to a special, secret hiding place. But then one evening, he overheard a rather disturbing story or conversation between his mum and his dad. His dad said, "I think I'm going to cut down that old fruit tree behind our house. It hasn't borne any fruit for years." The little boy was rather concerned. "If I beg Dad not to cut down the fruit tree, then he'll find out all about my secret hiding place, and it won't be a secret anymore." So he thought for a moment. And then suddenly he had an intriguing plan. There were several apple trees in the field just behind. He decided he would go out that night when it was dark and collect a basket full of apples. And later on, whenever his parents weren't looking, he would climb up his old fruit tree and he would tie stems of the apples to every branch. The following morning, his father went out and he looked at the old tree. He was amazed to see it was suddenly laden full of apples, big, fat, juicy ones. The little boy waited to see his father's reaction. Dad came back inside. He had a twinkle in his eye. He said, "Dear, you're not going to believe it. A miracle took place last night. That old fruit tree, it's full of apples. Fat, juicy apples on nearly every branch." The wife smiled. "That's amazing," she said. "Yes," said Dad. "It's a double miracle. You see, the old fruit tree is not an apple tree. It's actually a pear tree." We might laugh at that tale, But we know the long-established principle of the harvest, don't we? That you will always reap what you sow. Whenever a person sows apple seeds, what do they get? They expect and they get apples. Whenever they sowed pear seeds, what do they get? They get pears. God always decreed that reaping would follow sowing. It's always been the case. We read in our call to worship, as long as the earth endures, seed time and harvest will never cease. Turn with me this evening to Galatians chapter 6. And we're going to look especially at the verses 7 to 10 under the heading, "You will reap what you sow." It's a principle of the harvest. You will reap what you sow. The first thing I want you to note this evening is how Paul warns us in verse 7 about the dangerous deception. Dangerous deception. The reason why God, the Holy Spirit, originally inspired the Apostle Paul to pen the letter to the Galatians was because false teachers were deceiving the young Christian church in Galatia. False teachers were teaching what Paul has already referred to in the opening chapter, chapter 1 and verse 16, as another or a different gospel. You see, at that time in the early church, there were a group of people, they were called the Judaizers. And they insisted that Gentiles who converted to Christianity, first of all, had to adhere to some of the Old Testament Jewish laws. They had to be circumcised, for instance, before they would properly be accepted as a true follower of the one true living God. But the Apostle Paul wants to vehemently refute this deception. He wants his readers to understand the true way of salvation. And he wants you and me here this evening to realize that we can only be truly saved, friends, whenever we trust in the finished work of Jesus Christ on the cross, plus nothing. Paul is warning us here there is no need to add external religious rules to the gospel. There's absolutely nothing a person can add to his own salvation. The only thing, as Luther once said, we can contribute to it is our sin. And then we must turn from our sin and trust in Christ who died for our sin at Calvary. Don't be dangerously deceived that there's any other way to be saved. Salvation is all of God through faith in Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord. Can I ask you this evening, do you know this freedom that the gospel proclaims here and that Paul is writing about in Galatians? Have you been freed from the penalty and the power of sin? Because you have turned from sin, you have trusted in Christ, and you are bearing fruit in keeping with repentance. If you look over there to chapter 5 and verse 1, and there we read the whole purpose, in a sense, of this letter. It says in Galatians 5 and verse 1, "For freedom, Christ has set us free." If we were Pentecostals, we would cry hallelujah. "For freedom, Christ has set us free. Stand firm, therefore, and do not submit again to a yoke of slavery." What's he saying here? He's saying if you're a Christian this evening, you've been set free from your sin. You've been set free from all those religious rules that people tell you you must keep. Set free to sow seed, which will glorify the Savior. You see, dear friends, adherence to petty external outward rules saves no one, and it no longer is a necessity. But this is the dangerous deception that the Judaizers were teaching. This is the dangerous deception that some sects, even within the so-called Christianity, would teach today, that you must adhere to certain forms of behavior before you are a true child of God. It seemed that these Judaizers were teaching that keeping petty external rules, external things, were more important than the internal in bearing fruit in keeping with repentance. They were saying it didn't really matter what type of seed a person sowed in their life as long as they looked the part on the outside. Paul warns here in verse 7, "Do not be deceived. God is not mocked, for whatever one sows, that will he also reap." And friends, the same deception is infiltrating the minds of certain people today as Satan whispers perhaps into your mind tonight, "Listen, Mary, you do not need to submit to Jesus Christ. Satan dangerously deceives people. Perhaps he's deceiving you here this evening. He's saying, listen, you don't need to be saved. You don't need to yield your life to God. You don't need to allow God, the Holy Spirit, to transform you from the inside. Oh, just put on an outward veneer of religion. Put on your best suit. Put on your tie. Put on your best dress. Go to church on a Sunday, and you'll be all right. People are being dangerously deceived today when they think that's the way of salvation. Maybe you're here this evening in church and you think you can somehow deceive God. You can pull the wool over God's eyes. You think, oh, God doesn't really know me internally. I'll go to church. I'll look good. I maybe even go to the prayer meeting. And I'll look really good. Friends, do not be deceived. God will not be mocked. For whatever one sows, that will he reap. The Apostle Paul is basically saying to you here this evening, if you're falling to that category, you're not deceiving God. God knows exactly the state of your heart. God knows what type of seed you're sowing, and whatever you sow, that will you reap. And sadly, down through the ages, people have tried to mock God. People have tried to even to fool God. Think of how Goliath in the Old Testament mocked God, and he ended up with a stone in his head and a sword in his neck. Think about in the New Testament how King Herod mocked God and he ended up eaten by worms and died. And today people both inside the church and outside the church will continue to mock God. They will say, I don't need to submit to Christ. But on the day of the final harvest of souls, you will reap what you sow. Don't be dangerously deceived. There is one way to salvation, and that's through Jesus Christ. I'm not a farmer, as you know, but if I was to ask any of the farmers, why do you sow seed? You would probably all say it's because I want a good harvest. Wise sowers always sow with the harvest in mind. But I think, sadly, there's many people who don't sow with the final spiritual harvest in mind. They live their life for the here and now. Dangerously deceiving that somehow just by doing a good work for their neighbor, maybe you're a farmer in the area and you're quite good at helping out other farmers whenever they need it. And you think somehow that on the day of judgment, God will tot up all those good deeds that you've done and that'll be enough for you to get through and to squeeze into heaven. Friends, do not be deceived. Paul warns us, secondly, in this text about another danger, the danger of sowing seeds of corruption. The danger of sowing seeds of corruption. This morning I referred to that text in Hosea chapter 8 and in verse 7 where we read, if you sow the wind, you'll reap the whirlwind. If you sow the wind, you'll reap the whirlwind. We heard the appeal from Hosea chapter 10 and verse 12, sow for yourself righteousness, reap steadfast love, break up your fallow ground. It is time to seek the Lord. Have you sought him since this morning? Has God been speaking to you all afternoon and you're still not yielding your life to him? If so, be very careful. Here the Apostle Paul applies this principle in verse 8 of Galatians chapter 6. He says, the one who sows to his own flesh will from the flesh reap corruption. The one who sows to his own flesh from the flesh will reap corruption. What does it mean to sow to the flesh? Well, to sow to the flesh simply means to live according to our sinful nature. It refers to the sinful nature that every single one of us inherit from Adam. We're born with this natural tendency to rebel against God, to sow seeds of sin. Our actions, our attitudes, our thoughts all arise from a sinful heart that we're all born with. Have you ever considered, for example, how a worm gets inside an apple? What happens? An insect lays an egg in the apple blossom, and then sometimes later, the worm hatches in the heart of the apple and then begins to eat its way out. Sin like the worm begins in our hearts. And sin then hatches and it works its way out through our thoughts, through our words, through our attitudes, through our actions, through our reactions. And both Christians and non-Christians alike, we naturally sow to the flesh because our hearts are naturally sinful. Look again back at Galatians chapter 5 and in verse 19 to 21, you will read what Paul has already warned the people about. Galatians 5 and 19, we read these words: the works of the flesh are evident. Sexual immorality, impurity, sensuality. Oh, but you say I wouldn't do any of those things, no. But read on, idolatry. Are we not all guilty of idolatry in some way or the other? Remember, idolatry is allowing something to come between us and God. Sorcery, not me, no. Enmity, no. Strife, jealous, me. Fits of anger, rivalries, dissensions, divisions, envy, drunkenness, orgies, things like these. I warn you, as I warned you before, that those who do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. As you read through that list in Galatians 5, 19 to 21, certainly perhaps you might think, oh, no, there's about half of them. No, I wouldn't do half of those. But I would challenge every single person in here tonight, myself included, that there's at least 50% of those that I am guilty of. And if you're honest enough, you're guilty of too. And the Bible says here that those who do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. We will not be in glory. Full stop. You see, the truth is our actions will have consequences. Our present conduct and how we sow in this life will determine our future, both in this life and in the life to come. The saying is so true: sow a thought, reap an act. Sow an act, reap a habit. Sow a habit, reap a character. Sow a character, reap a destiny. Many people will reap a destiny of corruption in the very pit of hell because they continue to sow to the flesh. You see, friends, living for the flesh, living for sin, will ultimately yield a miserable harvest. Galatians 5 and 21 says that such people will not inherit the kingdom of God. Can I ask you this evening, in what way are you sowing to the flesh? Be honest. In what way are you sowing to the flesh? Have you ever loved something before God? Have you ever decided to do something rather than spend time with God? Have you ever been jealous of someone else? Have you ever been angry? We all have committed these sins. The scripture says, don't be deceived. One day you will reap what you sow. One day you will stand before God, Jesus Christ, the Lord of the harvest, and on that day, souls will be harvested for eternity. And those who continue to sow seeds of corruption without turning to Christ in repentance and in faith will be separated from God forever and cast into the eternal lake of fire. Dangerous deception. Sowing seeds of corruption. But thirdly, I want you to note that there is a better way to sow. And we'll call it sowing seeds of life. You see, whenever a farmer sows a good seed in a fertile field, what happens? It yields a rich harvest. And the same thing applies in the spiritual realm. Those who are wise, those who desire a good harvest, spiritually speaking, who want to be with God in heaven, and whenever they die, whenever he comes, will be careful to sow seeds of life. Because Galatians chapter 6 and verse 8 tells us, the one who sows to his own flesh from the flesh will reap corruption, but, and this is the good news, the one who sows to the Spirit will from the Spirit reap eternal life. That's good news, isn't it? The one who sows to the Spirit from the Spirit will reap eternal life. But maybe you're asking, Noel, how can I sow to the Spirit? What does that mean? Well, first of all, as we heard this morning, the fallow ground must be broken up. God, the Holy Spirit, must convict us of our sin. We must repent from our sin. And we must trust in Christ as our Savior and Lord. Can I ask you, has that happened as yet in your life? Has God, the Holy Spirit, made you aware of your sinful nature? Has that still small voice of God, the Holy Spirit, convicted you, made you feel guilty over your sin? Have you wisely turned from it? And have you started to sow seeds of life? You see, until you're converted, Until you humbly yield your life to Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord, you cannot sow seeds of life. You will continue to sow seeds of corruption. But the moment you're saved, a spiritual battle begins within your heart between the new and the old nature. And of course, we call that the flesh and the spirit. And the true child of God, as we submit daily to the power of the Spirit within us, we have the power, and we'll look at that in Romans 8 on Wednesday evening, to crucify the flesh and to sow to the Spirit. Galatians 5 and 16, again, we're referring a lot to Galatians 5, the previous chapter, because it would be good, and we probably will sometime come back to do the whole of this book. But in Galatians 5 and 16, we read these words. Paul commands us, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. Galatians 5 and verse 18, he's already called us, be led by the Spirit. Galatians 5 and 25, he commands us, keep in step with the Spirit. What does it mean to sow to the Spirit? It means to follow the Spirit's lead in all things. It means to obey God, the Holy Spirit, and his instructions that we read in the Bible and through prayer, and as we know how we should live our life, we're to live that way. Are you living that way? In agreement with what the Bible tells you? Putting God first and everything else second? Of course, sowing to the Spirit means also to sow the kind of seed that comes from the fruit of the Spirit. In Galatians 5 and verse 22 and 23, we read these words, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Do other people see those fruit in your life? If you're a Christian, do they see the love and the joy and the peace and the patience and the kindness and the goodness and the faithfulness and the gentleness and the self-control? I'm not saying do they see perfection, but do they see those characteristic traits in your life? They should if you're a true child of God. And how can we cultivate such fruit in our lives? Well, we can cultivate such fruit whenever we avail of the means of grace that God has provided for us to live fruitful lives. You see, God has given us all we need. God has given us the Word of God as a means of grace. He's given us prayer. He's given us the opportunity to worship together. He's given us the sacraments. These are the means of grace that God wants Christians to use that we might sow seeds of life, that we might bear fruit in keeping with repentance and grow in the fruit of the Spirit. Can I ask you how good again, or how diligent are you in availing of the means of grace? When was the last time you read your Bible? When was the last time you prayed? Do you make it a priority to be in church every Sunday morning, not just at harvest time? And every Sunday evening, not just at harvest time? These are the means of grace that God uses to develop fruitful lives in his people. The more we use them, the better we will grow. Farmers, you know this evening that the more seed you sow, the more you will reap at harvest time. It's the same in the spiritual realm. 2 Corinthians 9 and verse 6 says, whoever sows sparingly will reap sparingly. Whoever sows generously will reap generously. If you want to grow in the faith as a Christian, what's the answer? There's no quick shortcut to mature Christianity. It's hard work. It's availing of the means of grace. The Word of God, prayer, midweek, all these things. And yet, with all, how many people do not come to midweek? How many people only come to the occasional service? And then they wonder, why am I not making progress in my Christian life? Friends, it's very simple. Can I ask you this evening, how fruitful are you? How diligent are you in sowing to the Spirit? Sowing it's hard work. Let's be honest, it's tough. It's hard work. Farmers, you farmers this evening, those of you who have invested many hours throughout the winter, you know that the sowing involves hard labor, doesn't it? There's probably some wet and wintry days whenever you felt like giving up, whenever you grew weary. The same is true with Christians, if we're honest with ourselves. And Paul's aware of that. And look at what he says there in verse 9. He encourages us in verse 9. Sorry, Martin, something's happened there. He encourages us in verse 9 to keep up the good work. Keep up the good work. Look at verse 9. Let us not grow weary of doing good, for in due season we will reap if we do not give up. Let us not grow weary of doing good, for in due season we will reap if we do not give up. It's easy to grow weary as a farmer, isn't it? It's easy to grow weary no matter what work you're employed in. But it's also easy to grow weary and to lose heart as a Christian. We can burn out, can't we? We can get tired. And let's be honest, even as a minister of the gospel, we can be discouraged at times. We can be disappointed. We can see the apathy and the lack of interest. And at times we think, I might as well give up. Maybe you're a believer here this evening. Maybe you've been faithfully sowing the seed for years, but you're growing weary. You're tired. You feel it giving up. Maybe the little boy in the story at the beginning. You need to get away to whatever your fruit tree is, to that special place, alone with the Lord, where he can renew your strength. This afternoon, I have to confess, I was feeling a wee bit tired. Sometimes whenever you're preaching, yes, we're human, we feel tired, I felt a wee bit down. And what did I do? I went for a walk up Shilnavogi. Spent half an hour, and that's one of my quiet places, in prayer. And again, as people would have driven past me perhaps in the car, they maybe would have thought I was crazy, because after 15 minutes, I began to sing. You see, this is what we need to do. We need to get away to that quiet place at times where the Lord indeed can renew us. Isaiah 40 and 29 says that the Lord gives power to the faint. To him who has no might, he increases his strength. Even youths shall faint and be weary, and young men shall fall exhausted. But they who wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not grow weary. They shall walk and not faint. The word of God encourages us, brothers and sisters in Christ, to keep on keeping on. To press on towards the goal. Why? Because a day of reaping, a final harvest is coming, and eternal life is the reward of all who persevere to the end. And so he concludes with a command there in verse 10, just very briefly, to do good. As we have opportunity, let us do good to everyone, especially to those who are of the household of faith. I wonder, brothers and sisters in Christ, are we doing good to everyone? Those deeds of love, they're evidence of a renewed heart. Those goods of love, deeds of love, sorry, done for people inside the church as well as outside of the church are evidence that we're true children of God. Can I ask you, are you loving your brothers and sisters here in Glenwary? And again, I say all of them, not just the ones who you naturally click with. Are you demonstrating that love for one another with acts of kindness? Are you quick to forgive others within this fellowship, overlooking their feelings? And are you also taking time to sow the gospel seed to those who don't belong to it? We said on Wednesday evening that at midweek the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Don't be deceived this evening. You will reap what you sow. Be careful with dangerous deception. Be careful thinking that it's just all about rules. Outward adherence, that's not what the gospel teaches. Be careful not to continue to sow seeds of corruption. Yes, there's always that battle for Christians between the new nature and the old flesh. But our priority, as we yield daily to the Spirit within us, is to sow seeds of life to grow in the fruit of the Spirit. Maybe this evening there's someone gathered and as yet you know what you're going to reap. You know at the end of time, whenever Christ either comes or called, you're not ready. You're not saved. You've deceived yourself for years, and you know what will happen whenever you die. If that's this evening, can I encourage you, as I said this morning, to seek the Lord? It is time to seek the Lord. Whether you be 8 or 80. No one knows if we'll ever hear the gospel again. No one knows if you'll be here next harvest. It is time to seek the Lord, because you reap what you sow. For those of us this evening who are Christians, brothers and sisters, can I encourage you to submit fully to the transforming work of the Spirit in your life? Spend time daily in the Word and in prayer. Make midweek and morning and evening services a priority, that you might grow in the power of the Spirit, producing fruit for his glory. And as you grow, may you love others in the fellowship, both in action and in word. You reap what you sow. Let's pray together. Father, once again, we do thank you for your word. And Father, we realize that it is only the work of your Holy Spirit within the hearts of both the believer and the unbeliever that can bear forth fruit as a result of the preaching of the word. And so we leave this word to you and to your Spirit, and we pray earnestly by your Holy Spirit, you will wing it home. And you will apply it to each individual here this evening, and you will meet each one of us at our particular point of need. If there's any of us who are not yet saved, Lord, we long that none of us would not avail of this opportunity to seek Christ and to yield to him. If there's any of us perhaps who have backslidden, Lord, we pray that we would return to Christ and we would love you as our first love. And we would be diligent then about the means of grace. And we wouldn't just let this Sunday be a Sunday when we came to church in the morning or perhaps in the evening. But it would be the beginning of an opportunity to recommit our lives to you. Oh, Father, grant us the grace and the humility. Help us to put things in perspective. And help us to love you and serve you as you want us so to do. Hear our prayer, we cry, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Our closing hymn again, lovely harvest hymn number 618. We plough the fields and scatter the good seed on the land. I don't think you could have harvest without singing. We plough the fields and scatter. And now may grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit rest and remain with each and every one of us this night and forevermore. Amen.